one of the main commandments for the Feast of Tabernacles is to be joyful, to have joy for 7 days. What does this word joy mean? Well, to help us grow in discernment of this term, we're going to look at the use of the word chara, joy, in the Gospel of Matthew. Shalom, welcome to Rob on the Rock. I'm Rob Van Hoff, and today, in celebration of the first day of Sukkot, which is a festival of simcha, of joy, I'm going to zero in on the use of the Greek word chara, chara. You see it here with the chi, alpha, rho, alpha, chara. And it's a word that means joy, the experience of gladness. And we're going to zero in on the use of this word in the Gospel of Matthew to gain some discernment about this word chara and joy. What is the kind of joy that we want to meditate upon and to be our focus through the Feast of Sukkot? To open, we're going to look at Psalm 5, 11 and 12, where it says, "But let all who take refuge in you be glad. Let them ever sing for joy. And you will shelter them, that those who love your name may exult in you. For you will bless the righteous, O Adonai. You crown him with favor as with a shield." Now, this is a beautiful passage from Psalm 5. I want to bring your attention not only to let them ever sing for joy, le'olam, but you will shelter them. And this verb shelter comes from the same word we get sukkah, which is a shelter or a tent. He will cover them. He will shelter over them. So the imagery here of finding refuge in the name of God, in those who love him, finding their protection, their provision, and their identity in him alone. That's what this is about. Okay, now we're going to, with that in mind, look at the passages from the Gospel of Matthew where the word chara exists. And then at the very end, we'll recap them. The first is in chapter 2. It's with the Magi coming from the east, anticipating to see the one born king of the Jews. After hearing the king, that is Herod, they went their way, the Magi did. And the star which they had seen in the east went on before them until it came and stood over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. This is chara. After coming into the house, they saw the child with Miriam, or Mary, his mother, and they fell to the ground and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they presented to him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And here we just want to look at the context that qualifies the joy that they felt. Remember, this is the experience of joy. And the context, of course, is they hadn't even yet seen the baby. They hadn't seen the child Yeshua yet. But by faith, they knew who it was they were coming to worship. And that anticipation alone was a source of joy. It's a beautiful story, of course, but also gives us context for the meaning of chara. Now let's look another, the next use of chara in the Gospel of Matthew is Yeshua's parable of the sower. And he talks about here, the one on whom seed was sown on the rocky places. This is the man who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no firm root in himself, but is only temporary. And when affliction or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he falls away. So here we have the same word, chara, joy. But the qualification given by the context is that this joy is not enduring. Remember in Psalm 5 where it says they will rejoice in his name forever, right? They will sing praises to his name forever and he will protect them. Well, this joy is still called chara. However, the context qualifies for us that there's no firm root in this person and it's only temporary. It's not le'olam. And when affliction and persecution arises, he falls away. So we need to look at joy in our lives, and we have to discern, is the joy that I have temporal and passing, or is the joy I have eternal and enduring? Let's continue. Matthew 13:44, another beautiful parable, just one line. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in the field, which a man found and hid again. And from joy over it, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. So here we have chara, joy used akin in Matthew, but the qualification provided for us by the context shows us that this is a different kind of joy than the one who received it but had no root in himself. This person, they went and sold all that they had to buy that field. So we see that the act of the joy, out of the joy, is one that treasures this treasure of the kingdom of heaven. It treasures the things of the kingdom of heaven more than anything that's in the world. And that is born of true faith. That's unlike the parable of the sower, where the person who receives it with joy but has no root. They lack discernment. They lack enduring capacity. And that means they were not all in. Let's continue here. Here in Matthew 25, we hear the explanation of another parable where we see joy of the master twice. Now, we're just cutting in here at the end of the parable. It says, the one who had received the 5 talents came up and brought 5 more talents, saying, Master, you entrusted 5 talents to me. See, I have gained 5 more talents. His master said to him, well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. So here we know that chara, joy, is a good thing, and that joy that he enters into is his master's favor. Back to Psalm 5, remember that it says that he protects and will bless the righteous and crown them. Literally, he will crown them with favor. He will guard them and surround them with favor, like a shield. So the joy is actually coming from the master who has the power and the strength. Again, also, the one who had received the 2 talents came up and said, Master, you entrusted 2 talents to me. See, I have gained 2 more talents. His master said to him, well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. So here, clearly, it is a desirable thing for those who love Yeshua to be pleasing to him, to be in his favor, and to enjoy his protection, his blessing, his provision, and trust him with all things. And again, that's different than trusting in the things of the world. Just like we saw earlier in the parable of the one who found the treasure hidden in the field, out of joy he went and sold everything he had so he could trade up, because he knew what was truly valuable was hidden in that field. And that's a parable, of course, for discerning the true things of the kingdom and where true joy is found. Unlike the person who hears the word and receives it with joy, but actually has no root. So they actually have no capacity to hold on to what is good and true because they've been invested in the wrong things. Finally, the last use of chara, of joy, in the Gospel of Matthew comes with the resurrection. In Matthew 28, we learn of the women who go to the tomb, and the angel tells them, this is the angel speaking to the women, go quickly, tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And behold, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. And they, that is the women, left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy, chara, and ran to report it to his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and greeted them, and they came up and took hold of his feet and worshiped him. So that's the last use of χαρα in the Gospel of Matthew. And if we just look at these as little gems of wisdom woven in the narrative of the Gospel of Matthew, we can see the bookends. The first use of joy is the Magi coming from the east. They haven't seen the baby Yeshua yet, but they've heard him. They heard of him. They knew he was born. And they, of great joy, came to worship him. The last use of χαρα is like a bookend to that. It's not before his birth. It's those who spent time with Yeshua at the end of his life, who witnessed the crucifixion, his suffering, of course, and now have seen the empty tomb, have heard of his resurrection, and are absolutely filled with joy. And they ran to tell. These are women running to tell the disciples that he is risen. And of course, when he meets them and greets them, it says they took hold of his feet and worshiped him. So the bookends both involve worship of Yeshua. First is the χαρα of the wise men at the birth of Yeshua. I guess he's about 2 years old maybe then. He's still a child. And here, post-resurrection, the resurrected Yeshua. So both bookends in the Gospel of Matthew of joy, of χαρα, pertain to the person of Yeshua, his coming, and his completed work in his resurrection. And in the middle, we have the uses in the parables of what is χαρα, what is true joy, discerned what is from the kingdom and enduring from what is temporal and not enduring. And I just have a quick little list here to recap those. So joy in the Gospel of Matthew. Again, the book ends, the first occurrence with the Magi, anticipation of worshiping the king. And the last is those women who carried the news of the risen Messiah, both involving worship of Yeshua. And the ones in the middle, we have the one who receives the word with joy, but has no root. So that joy is not sufficient for enduring. It is not reflective of accurate value of what is the heavenly treasure. Otherwise, they would hold to it and cling to it. Such as the next example, the one who sells all he has to purchase the field. That person has what it takes to endure because they're all in. They're loving God with all their heart, all their soul, all their strength. There's nothing in this world they're invested in that would conflict with that that clinging to the Lord. And then, of course, we see the two examples, the one entrusted with 5 talents and the one entrusted with 2 talents, each of whom receive additional authority from the Lord. And he says to them, "Well done, enter into the joy of your master." And of course, that is the desire of the disciples of Yeshua, is to abide in his joy. And so with this in mind about χαρα, during the Feast of Sukkot, this is a time where we see ourselves as looking back through the year and the lessons of all the feasts that we were slaves. We were delivered from slavery. We had time in the wilderness dwelling in Sukkot. And now we, having received God's law, recognizing and repenting of our sin, we've received atonement in abiding in our Messiah, in his risen joy, which is his resurrection life. And that's where we have our righteousness, and that's where we have our true identity for our souls. We are washed clean of our sin, and we are forgiven our trespasses, and we have a new name. We have new life, new creation life with the Lord. And this is the celebration of Sukkot. 7 days, it says, you will have only joy, simcha, joy. So I hope that this meditation on χαρα, joy, in the Gospel of Matthew will be good food for thought for your celebration of Sukkot. Shalom.